This is Fabrizio Romano, and here we go.
Ciao Fabrizio, come stai?
Ciao, bene, bene, thank you, I'm fine. Thank you. Congrats for your Italian.
Parlo un po' italiano.
Ah, bene, bene.
Well, let's get straight into this. Thank you so much for joining us. When it comes to football transfers, you're one of the biggest names and the most respected in the business. How have you developed such strong connections and, most importantly, trust?
Yeah, it's been a long way, a long ride, just because I started when I was 17. Yes, 17. And I was in Napoli, Naples. Then I moved to Milano when I was 18. And my biggest luck has been to be here in Milano, because everything for European football, Italian football, but I would say European football is in Milano, with many agents, many directors, not just of Italian clubs, but also of European clubs are staying in Milano during the transfer window for meetings and this kind of things. It's the city of transfers. And so going around the city during the summer, during January transfer window, for me has been key to be always in touch with people. Also when I was younger, when I was 18, 19, I was going around the city, spending 3 months around the city during the transfer window, meeting with people, having new contacts. And then at the same time, trying to develop my work also on social media. So not just on traditional channels, but also on social media to try to bring the news on to all people on my channels and not only on the channels where I was and I am working. And so that's how people were starting to trust me. It was not easy when I was starting, because of course people didn't know me. So they were trusting me just because they were trusting the person, but not the journalist, because they didn't know about me and my story. Now it's easier, but every day is a fight, because you have to be always connected, always checking and calling people, always having good relationships. So it's absolutely not easy, but I think I'm really lucky, because working in football is the best thing that can happen to any people.
Yeah, it really is. Can you tell us a bit about those connections and those networks? What type of people are they?
Yes, first of all, the connections are with many different people in football. So it could be with agents, with directors, with presidents sometimes, with players sometimes also. Also, to be honest, players many times, they are the last ones to know where they're going to play. So many times it's agents, directors and presidents to help and to know the updates on transfers. Building this connection has been not so easy, because as I said, when I started, people didn't know about me or my story, so they were trusting me as a person, but not so much as a journalist, because I started when I was 18. So I was just trying to bring some news and to do my job. But to be honest, now I'm spending all my days since years and years to have new connections, to stay in touch with people, calling people. Social media are helping, because now they can see me on social media, of course, with my name and with my follow, but also try to enter in contact, to start contacts with people is important thanks to social media. So texting people on Instagram or texting people on Twitter, it was helping me a lot to try to bring new and to have new connections. And so my idea was, when I started, I was 17, I was 18 when I was starting with Sky Italy. And I had the opportunity of having first contacts with Italian football people, so like directors, agents here in Italy. But I wanted to try to bring Italian model of working on transfers, so to be always accurate, to check and check with different services before sharing any news. So this kind of model in European football, European transfers, was not so easy when I started, because you know it's not easy to open talks and start contacts with people from different countries, England, Spain, South America, many different countries. But then now I think it's the best part of my job, because I spend all my days to stay in contact with people, to have new updates, new info. Also now, when the window is closed, I'm always talking with people, trying to check, because you have to be prepared when the window is open to be always in touch with your sources. So it's a long process, but I really love it.
How's the Italian reporting different to other parts of Europe? You talk about the accuracy and that style.
Yes, I think now in many countries we have the same model. So now it seems basically the same in all countries, but 3, 4, 5 years ago was not like this. I think Spain is so similar to Italy. So we are obsessed with news, with transfers. We live for transfers, to have updates on the manager, on the players, where they're going to play and these kind of things. But in many other countries, in Germany, in England, in France, it was not like this. They were living transfers as, okay, part of the game, but not the crucial part of the game. Now for them is really important too. And I think it's thanks to the Italian and Spanish way of doing this job. So we are really obsessed with it. The model is to be always accurate, to be always ready to check your updates before sharing anything, in particular here in Italy. I think thanks to many journalists in Sky Italy, we were trying to bring something on transfers that is every day new updates, every day something accurate. You know, I think in England years ago, they were more interested in something like gossip or this kind of stuff more than football transfers. Okay, football transfers were part of the game, but not at this level. Now I think they are obsessed too with transfers, and I really like it because I think it's now we are in a moment where transfers are important as the football match. They are asking and they are caring more about the transfer than a football match. So they just want to know if their team are going to sign this player or not, more than if their team are going to win on Sunday or not. It's crazy sometimes, but this is how it's working. And the Italian model is about checking. Checking is the key word. Because really, before sharing in particular important news, so talking about important clubs or important players, is about checking with the two different clubs involved in the negotiation, with the player side, so with the agent. It's a long process, but be accurate is the message, is the key. And this is what we want to do. It's not about selling something to people, you know. I think it's the biggest idea of the social media, of trying to bring in transfers on social media years ago, is I don't need to sell people something because I don't have to sell a paper or a TV show. I just need to show people that I'm accurate and I'm trying to do a good job. So this is why I think social media try to show the best part of your job.
Yeah, and I guess that's why you're so trusted, because of your accuracy. You talk about social media and you have a lot of interaction on social media with the people that follow you. How important is it to stay communicated with the football community?
It's so important to me. It's so important, to be honest, in many different ways, because of course it's important because it's helping with your job, so people can trust you because they see that you're on social media, you are so big, so the news will be attracting a lot of people from different countries. But it's also important to me because I think transfer market is so beautiful because we have the interaction with fans. Without the fans, it would be so boring, to be honest. Without the fans, that they are celebrating when they sign a player, or sometimes people think that we as journalists, or me in my case, we are stressed if some people are always asking about the same name, the same transfer. It's not like this for me. It's not like this. I really like it. I think it's part of the passion for football and for transfers in this case. So when they are asking about a single player for 3 weeks, for 4 weeks, sometimes for years, because for example Sancho to Manchester United was like 18 months of negotiation, of talks, and people were asking Sancho every day. But I was not stressed or bored by this situation. I think it's part of the game, and I really like the interaction with people when they are reacting to the news, when they are shocked with something negative, but we are shocked with something positive too. Look, for example, at Manchester United fans with Cristiano Ronaldo, when the crazy news of Cristiano Ronaldo arrived during the afternoon. In the morning, it was seen in Manchester City 90%, and in the afternoon, it was Manchester United. And they were celebrating as they won the Champions League on social media. So I think this kind of interaction is something really important also for journalists to enjoy what we are doing, because if we only have to update on transfer without the reaction of people, it would be so boring. With fans reacting, I think is the best part of this job. For me, it's the best part of the job.
Yeah, it makes it so much more exciting. This recent transfer window, it was crazy with Lionel Messi going to PSG and Cristiano Ronaldo to Manchester United. There was so much going on and so much interest, so many rumours and everything happening so fast. How did you approach the chaos?
Yes, it's been really difficult, to be honest. First of all, I think it's been the best summer ever. Talking about transfers has been something incredible. So it's been surprising with big names, with a lot of crazy things, stuff happening. So it's been the best summer ever. Was really difficult by a journalistic point of view because, you know, for example, Leo Messi was in Barcelona to sign the new contract with Barca. They had the announcement scheduled in the night to announce Leo Messi staying, new contract, big celebration. And then they had the problem with La Liga during the day, and 2 days later, he was in Paris to sign with Paris Saint-Germain. And so it was so shocking for the fans, but also for me as a journalist, it was a total shock. So it's not easy in this moment to reconnect with the real world, to stay in touch with your sources, to try to understand what is really happening. Because sometimes also for sources, if they are directly involved in something so big, it's not easy for them to give updates and to say something in this kind of complicated situation. We're talking about Leo Messi. We're talking about Barcelona. He's a legend, an historical legend of football. So it's not easy also for sources to share something in this crazy moment. So imagine for a journalist how difficult it is to manage this kind of situation.
Do they hold back a lot of information because, you know, they don't want everything to get out?
Yes, exactly. So, you know, it's about the moments. I still remember during the afternoon for Leo Messi was crazy because it was really complicated for people to understand what was going to happen with La Liga, because it's something new. It's something new that a league is going to block something like Leo Messi and Barcelona. So it's something completely new. It's not that the player was not happy with the bid and he decided to go to Paris Saint-Germain. He was ready to sign and Barcelona were ready to sign. So they were 100% sure that everything was in place. And then Leo Messi was going to join Paris Saint-Germain because the problem was with La Liga. So it was something absolutely new. And this is why it was surprising. And this is why it was difficult by a journalistic point of view. Also in the following days, for Leo Messi was so difficult to manage with many fake news. Many people saying Leo Messi is already in Paris, Leo Messi is in Ibiza, Barcelona are trying to convince Leo Messi to sign a new contract in a new way. So a lot of fake news, but I think was a good experience. As a journalist, I really loved it because it was a good experience for the future. And I really loved this day, these days, because it was difficult, it was shocking, but it's helping to make people understand that in transfer, everything is possible, as I always say. So till you sign something, everything can happen. It's a jungle. And I think people have to enjoy this world as it is. And for Cristiano Ronaldo also was so complicated because when you talk about such big names, people are expecting always updates every minute. So if you talk about Ronaldo and Messi, they want updates every single minute. Many times they don't understand that they need some time. They, like agents, directors, clubs, they need some time before having an agreement. But to be honest, for Cristiano Ronaldo, when they were spending 3-4 days between Manchester City and Cristiano agents and they were not signing any contract, the feeling was something is happening, something strange is happening. With Messi, it was a shock in 24 hours. With Cristiano, it was a bit longer, but it's really, really complicated to stay in touch with the right sources at the right moment. And I'm really happy because I think it was a big experience for the footballers.
And your sources during the Messi and Ronaldo transfers, I'm sure you can't exactly say who they are, but are they... The agents or the people around
the team? I will never say. Or they will kill me.
We want to know.
I will never say. No, I can't say, but of course it's from different sides. In this kind of deals, it's from different sides. You can talk only with one single side. It's important to have sources in the clubs, close to the players, so with different sides, because when they are so big, it's not a small transfer between small clubs. In this case, you can need one single good source and you're okay. With top names and top clubs, you always need to check with different sources or you have a problem.
Yeah, so there's a lot of people involved, I imagine.
Yes. Always a lot of people with these kind of names. With Mbappé, Mbappé was not going to Real Madrid, but they were trying to sign Kylian Mbappé. And there were many people involved between the two clubs, close to the player, intermediaries, agents, family, was many, many people involved. So it's easier for a journalist.
Do you think Mbappé is eventually going to go to Real Madrid? There are rumors that January is the time that he will.
I'm sure they want to try again. I don't know if it will be January or next summer, but they will try again. Kylian Mbappé has a dream of playing for Real Madrid one day, so they know about it. They know that Kylian Mbappé wants to play for Real Madrid. Let's see if it will be next summer as free agent or in the future, but one day he wants to wear Real Madrid shirt. And so I'm sure that they will try again. Florentino Perez wants Kylian Mbappé, and I think they were really serious this summer, offering 180 million euros for a player who is out of contract in 6 months. He will be free to sign with any other club. Was like saying to Mbappé, to his family, to his agents, we only want you. You are our priority. So it was a big message, a strong message to Mbappé too. And I think that Real Madrid have good chances to sign Mbappé in the future. We'll see if January, summer or in the future, but they want you.
Can you share with us any huge footballers whose deals may have fallen through, whether that be in the last transfer window or over the years?
the biggest case I had was, I can mention you two, for example, or three. I'm going to mention three midfielders. Last summer has been with Wijnaldum to Barcelona. It was a done deal. It was agreed. So they already planned for medical for Wijnaldum to Barcelona. They were planned for medical, for announcement. Everything was in place. The medical staff of Barcelona was ready to go to Dutch national camp to have the medical with the player during the Euros. So everything was in place. And then Paris Saint-Germain made him a new bid, more than doubled salary. So it was a huge bid to Gini Wijnaldum. Pochettino was calling him. They were trying to convince the player and they did it. So they changed their mind in 24 hours. During one single night, Wijnaldum changed his mind and said to Barcelona, sorry, but I'm going to Paris Saint-Germain. But it was agreed, verbally agreed. They were preparing the contracts. So sometimes in transfers, crazy things happen. David Silva, Spain midfielder, former Manchester City player, now he's with Real Sociedad. Before going to Real Sociedad from Manchester City, he was new Lazio player to join Serie A side Lazio. Was done. It was completely done. They were waiting for the player to arrive in Rome during the weekend to have the medical. And then what happened with his family? He decided to go back to Spain, that he wanted to change his mind because Spain was his favorite destination. And so Lazio director was furious and he said in public, we are really disappointed with David Silva. I was happy about this interview of the director because people were attacking me saying, you say it is done for David Silva to Lazio. And I said, if he changes his mind, I'm not David Silva himself.
I'm not the situation
and I can't sign contracts. And so the director of Lazio confirmed that it was completely done. And another one was Adrien Rabiot, French national team midfielder, Juventus midfielder. And before joining Juventus, he had an agreement with Barcelona. And you imagine he signed a pre-contract with Barcelona. So the pre-contract between Adrien Rabiot and Barcelona was signed and done. But then the player, pre-contracts are not valid, are just a private agreement. It's not an official agreement. So from Barcelona, they were convinced that Rabiot was going to join. But then he changed his mind also and he said, I want to go to Juventus because of the manager, because of many things. And so together with his mom, with the agent of Adrien Rabiot, he decided to change and to go to Juventus. And for Barcelona was a shock. But I think with free agents, if you look, all these players are free agents. Wijnaldum, David Silva, Adrien Rabiot was a free agent at this moment. So free agents can change their mind till last minute, till they sign the contract. Because when you have two clubs, it's different. The process is easier because for a journalist, because you can talk with the two clubs, and when two clubs have an agreement, okay, for the player, he's going to this club. But between player and club, so with not two clubs involved, only one single club and free agent player, it's really complicated because they can change their mind in 5 minutes. It's crazy.
Now, a question I've got that's probably different to anything you've been asked for before. How much do you know about Australian footballers in Europe?
Something in the past, to be honest, now not so much. In the past, of course, with Eric Ewell, with many others, of course, yes, but now not so much with Viduka, if I'm not wrong. Yes, someone I remember, Cahill, of course, now not so much, to be honest, but if you can mention me some name, maybe yes.
what's the perception of Aussie players among the agents? Would you know?
I think it's always a good feeling. Of course, it's not in this moment. It's not about the biggest topics. Of course, you can imagine for European football, but the opinion is always so good in general about Australian football and Australian players. It's always about serious professionals, and this is something really good and really important, I think, in today's football, because many times when you have young players from countries like South America or Latino countries in Europe, like Italy, Spain, Portugal, sometimes they are so good, but as players, but as professionals, you always have to check because you never know how they are as professionals. And now many clubs, between agents, directors, they're looking for players who are good professionals, because now we have a problem, I think, in Europe with this topic. Many top players, but not always great professionals. When they are so young, they have a lot of money, they can have everything they want. And so sometimes they are not perfect professionals. So if they are really focused on football, you can see how good they are, like Erling Haaland, for example. He's an incredible professional, and so he's always performing at top level. But in some other times, you can see good players not having top performances because they are not top professionals. About Australian players, the consideration is always they are really good professionals, so serious. And I think this is something really good for the movement, also for the future.
Yeah, very disciplined, I suppose. If you have to pick your favorite Australian player, who would it be?
I would mention Eric Ewell. I love this player. I really love this player. I love quality players. So he had a lot of quality. He was a skillful player. I still remember him with Liverpool was really, really good in some moments. So I would go for him. Yes.
Yeah, he's very, very talented. Now, yes. Your famous saying is, here we go. What requires a here we go? Because that's when it's confirmation, right?
Yes, when I have everything confirmed by my sources, basically. So when everything is really agreed, verbally agreed, because contract signed means that it's going to be official in some minutes maybe or in some hours, so it's too easy. So when it's verbally agreed and when everything is really verbally agreed, for me is here we go. So it means that I'm sure that my sources could be one or two or three different sources. It depends by the level of the source. I have sources I 100% trust and they can give me a call and tell me three words, and for me it's a here we go because I trust them 100%. And I have sources that I always need to check two or three times with different people. So it depends. But for me, it's important that everything is verbally agreed and I am 100% sure that something is really happening. So for me, it's here we go when something is 100% happening and something is agreed. Then if they sign the contract, it's not up to me.
Yeah. Is there a story behind the here we go? How did it come about?
It was totally casual, totally random. I was just tweeting about Manchester United move. I don't remember the name because it was not planned. So it was not planned for me to have a brand or something like this. And so I was tweeting about this move since weeks. It was long negotiation. And then at the end of this negotiation, I tweeted, it was 3 years ago. I tweeted, okay, finally now it's done, completed, and here we go. Like saying, okay, finally we can move to the next one because it was a long one. Okay, we did it. And people were excited on Twitter, texting me like, here we go. Thank you, Fabrizio. Okay, I said, nice. Then the day after, I started to tweet about Chelsea, Man City, Liverpool, other clubs. And they started texting me under the tweet, Fabrizio, can we see here we go also for this other move to Liverpool, to Chelsea, to Arsenal? And I said, wow, so they want an approval for me. Okay, let's do it. And so I was trying to use the here we go in the following days. They were appreciating it. And I love it because it's just made together with my followers. So it was not something planned with an agency or by myself or something like this. It was just talking with people in a normal way on social media. This is why I love it.
Yeah, you can get t-shirts with here we go now.
Yes. Yes.
That'd be really good. Something interesting I wanted to ask is, how much sleep did you get during this recent transfer window? Because it was so crazy.
Yes. Sometimes it's crazy. Sometimes it's 4 hours, 5 hours. We could say around five, from 5 a.m. to 10 a.m. during the window. Then it depends, of course, depends by the moments. There are crazy moments where, for example, with Messi, Ronaldo, these kind of things, you can't sleep. You can't. It's like 3 hours, 4 hours, and you're fine because you want to be always under control of the situation. And so for me, sleeping from 4 a.m. to 8, 9 a.m. is fine. Some moments where you get some relax, of course, because we are humans, so I need it, of course, during the weekend, maybe. During the weekend, during the summer, many things are not happening, so it's a bit more relaxed. But during the week, it's like 5 hours, 4 hours. It depends by the moments, but yes, my sleeping schedule is a bit crazy during the window.
Yeah, and what about now? I imagine you'd be getting more sleep.
Now it's easier. Now it's easier, yes, of course. Now it's more relaxed. Of course, it's not that I'm sleeping like 9 or 10 hours because I'm not used to it. So for me, 7 hours is fine. Sometimes it's like sleeping 2 days, but it's really good. So I'm really not caring too much about it. Of course, I like to sleep when I can, but during the window, for me, it's really important to be under control of the situation. Because sometimes happened that maybe I was in the past, I was sleeping and I had some update and I was missing some update. Because I was sleeping, and so I said, okay, no, stop. I have to wake up earlier and go to sleep late. This is what I want.
Great. Thank you so much for that. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Time.
No problem.
Really
thank
appreciate
you. Thank
it.
Thank you, Michelle. Thank you.
Take care. Bye.
Bye. Ciao.